my son, because I have a PhD in poetry, I'm pretty militant about him reading. And, you know, we'd read the three books every night and all that stuff, and it was lovely, and sit in bed, do that, right? And then, you know, sons, boys, who has boys? If anybody has boys, you know that they just kind of go at four, they go,
I don't want to read,
you know. Now, thank God my son doesn't want to do DSIs and video games. He just likes going out in the dirt, which is cool. But John Barnett, whale rider. So John and I started a company about a year ago, a year and a half ago. I'll tell you about that later. But he's involved in a company that is taking children's books and comic books and graphic novels and making iPad applications from them, right? So things like this. You guys know Harry McClary from Donaldson's Dairy, right? My son loved the book, and then he stopped reading it. So this thing, I don't know if you can see it. Let me get back to the beginning. Right? So it's Harry, right? We all know Harry. Now, you can swipe, right? And then, you hear little sound effects? Okay.
Out of the gate and off for a walk.
It's David Tennant.
Harry McClary.
It's Doctor Who.
From Donaldson's
Dairy. Right? Now, tap on Harry. Yeah. Right, and then you double tap, so.
Gate. G. A. T. E.
Amazing. Now, this is a. Here's a prime example. Now, there's, you know, there's Hercule Morris, and there's Bodily Pots, right? Now, when you read Bodily Pots, right, Bodily Pots' spots are what color? Black, right? Now, if you have a paper book, now my son kept insisting that the spots were yellow. Now, a paper book, you've got to know clearly, son, we're going to have to check your eyesight. Now, if you use his paintings that he made on this, I'll show you how. Okay, spots are clearly yellow because he made the spots yellow, right? Because what you can do with this little puppy is, yeah, let's go to, well, let's go down. Whoop. Is there a painting here? Hang on. Yes, he decided the entire page would be red. But what you can do, I'll just go down the track, okay, is if you want to paint, okay, because who? Hey, who says the flowers are yellow? Who says? Right. Well, you go here, you go start painting, takes all the color away. Then you choose size of your brush, right? You choose the size of the brush here. I'll stand back a little bit. You go to the paint pot and you say, oh, I want the sky to be blue. Okay. All right. And if you're my son, you go, I want flowers to be purple. Right, and Harry McClary is clearly a little black dog, but to my son, he's orange. Right, then you go, yes, I love that. Then what's great is you can read, you know, David Tennant's Doctor Who and Harry McClary. You know, he's got that weird voice. Or I can go and start recording. I can go, and Harry McClary from Donaldson's Dairy. Right, then I use my narration, and Harry McClary from Donaldson's Dairy. Right. Now, I got a hold of these, and I went, you're kidding me. You are kidding me. Because I got an iPad, and I hated it. I thought it was a laptop replacement, you know, the whole thing, I have to be trendy. Hated it. You know, email sucks, doesn't have a camera, what the hell. Then I started, got the Kindle app, and started downloading movies to it, the whole thing. So, my partner, John Barnett, has backing in this company. The company's in trouble. Not enough money, not enough orders, all that kind of stuff. So I said, all right, I'm going to do a little experiment here. 2 years ago, I made up a story called Sam the Biggest Fire Truck. And I would tell it to my son every night. Sam was the biggest fire truck in the whole wide world. All he wanted was to be part of a fire engine company of his own, but he went to the city and the country and the neighborhoods, and all the fire trucks thought he was too big. Right? So, but when the biggest building in the world catches on fire, only Sam can put out the fire. Now, 2 days ago, there's Sam. Right?
Sam, the biggest, the biggest fire truck by Chris Adams.
I got published 2 days ago. They did all the art. They did everything. There's my son's drawings. So I'll use the originals.
Sam was the biggest fire truck in the whole wide world.
Right? I mean, you know, the whole cute thing. I recorded all of the narration on my iPhone. I literally just, I said, how am I going to do this? You know, you got David Tennant in a recording studio and the whole thing. And they said, oh, just use your iPhone. So I went to, you know, this app. That one, Voice Memos. Held it right here. Took me 8 minutes. Read it, emailed it from here. 2 days later, bang, on iTunes. Done. Insane, right? So this is the reason I'm telling you this. Why is he still there? Okay. Is because that to me, right now, when my son got Harry McLaren, when my son got Fleck the Little Fire Engine, he started reading again. My iPad now works, but my son is reading again, right? He will not put the iPhone or the iPad down. Then Sam the Biggest Fire Engine comes out, right? I brought it home and I said, Cooper, I have a really big surprise for you. And I went through the book with him. He cried. Five-year-old. Every single page, he hugged me. Because it was my voice. And it was his story. It was his story, right? That's how much I have to care in order to do that stuff. Now, this company's in trouble. They're undercapitalized. They're over in New Zealand. They have a founder who is amazing, but she can't keep anything straight. The books are a mess. Huge tax problems, massive liability to debt. I don't care. I'm going to save it. So, now, I have a huge piece of equity in the company. Plus, they've ordered 4 more books in the Sam series. Yes. But I went to my personal network. A buddy of mine I went to college with owns Platinum Studios, which is the publisher of All the Men in Blacks, Cowboys and Aliens. They have 150 comic book titles. I just did a 3-year, multi-million dollar deal with this company the other day, because I had to believe in it that much, right? This is not good for my career to back some little New Zealand-based technology company, but they have the best thing in the world, and my son is reading. All right? My son is reading. And that's how bad you have to want it. I don't care whether you're doing DACOs or social media or whatever, but you have to want it that bad, because it's never easy. And look, I can call up VCs and get hundreds of millions of dollars. These guys need, like, you know, a couple million bucks. Well, it's easier to raise 100 million than 10 million. It's easier to raise 10 million than 1. It's easier to raise 1 million than 100,000. Smaller the amount, the harder it is. But I think that that's an example of putting all of the media stuff together, right? It's that I got on a plane on my own money, and I went and sat down in Los Angeles and said, dude, you have to do this deal, and I'm not leaving until you do. And they did.
So apart from the fact we should train most of our students in sitting techniques, looking at that a different way, one of the things that concerns the traditional models and business models is that the 5-year-old who's used to that level of customization in a children's story on an iPad is one day going to be a 16-year-old or a 32-year-old sitting in a cinema.
Right.
Do you think that desire for customization and interactivity is going to flow through?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Look, it's. I mean, when they can make, you know, let's just be honest, okay? You can just see it. It was that big. Now it's this big, okay? How much bigger is this going to get, right? There's jokes. There's stuff you can download on YouTube where it's Steve Jobs. You know, every year he's got a bigger, you know, he's got the eye. You know, the iTray, and then he's got the iTV, and then it's the iCinema, and, you know, when you can actually go up and go, no, I don't like, you know, whoop, you know, you're flicking that and stuff like that. Look, I think there's always revolutionary technologies that scare academics and traditionalists and the old guard and anybody that was once cutting edge and incredibly new when we were all young and we were the ones pushing back against our parents' generations, and now we are the ones in power who have the money and our asses are on the line and our jobs depend on us not doing anything new but embracing new technology. Look, it's all the same damn thing. We all sit around campfires telling each other stories. Right? Doesn't matter. First person who picked up a flame and went, put it under their chin and went, boom, you know. So now we do it with a flashlight, right? I believe in human behavior. I believe we don't change. The thing I love about Facebook, Facebook's just the way we are, you know. Because if you're like a vapid, ego-casting idiot who wants your friends to know that you're putting your shoes on, guess what? Before Facebook, you probably called up your friends and went, hey, I put my shoes on, right? You probably just used the phone and SMS and then you used Yahoo Messenger and you were an annoying, obnoxious idiot, right? Money and social networks make you more of what you are. You know, if you're an asshole and you get rich, you're going to be a big asshole. You know, if you're a vapid, ego-casting jerk-off who cares nothing more about fashion and stuff like that and wants to tell all your girlfriends that you got your hair cut, right, you do it on the phone anyway. So I don't think that our DNA is... I don't think that any technology or our DNA is going to change as fast as technologies. I think our DNA will adapt to technologies, but we're all the same. That's my feelings anyway. So yes.
I have a question that's kind of linked in two parts. Do you think with the iPad, do you think it wasn't marketed correctly? And you know, people have picked it up. It's kind of like, what do I do with this? There is that real sense of like, well, I'm not a graphic designer, so I'm not going to, you know, put my programs on there and draw and sketch. Well, I'm not going to, you know, read my news on the bus like my dad does. Or I'm not, you know, and I'm not going to check my emails on there because I have my iPhone and then I have my laptop as well.
Yeah.
So that question, and then how will you market this new children's reading book application if it's attached to something like the iPad, and how are you going to market that? So are you going to make yourself personally responsible for marketing this and making lots and lots of sales? And so how are you going to get this company as well to take off in New Zealand and out of that debt as well, you know, kind of coinciding with the iPad?
So.
Or do you have a way out if it doesn't?
Of course I have a way out. always have a way out, right? You know, never jump off a bridge unless you're tied to something, right? Because all the rest of them go, let's do it, let's go, right? They go, whack. You know, it's not the fall that kills you. You know, it's the ground. You gotta be tied to something. So I'm gonna answer your first question, but I'm gonna show you what I'm doing. Oh, whoops. Okay, well, you guys can now hack my Facebook, but that's cool. Yes, it was marketed incorrectly. Okay. Block cookie?
Allow.
Okay. Now, here's what I'm doing about Sam. Alright. So, not 6 hours after the publication of iTunes, my kids' book, Sam, the Biggest Fire Truck, made the kidspot.com.au top 20. True. Okay. Here's a book I just published. I got published. Okay, shameless self-promotion. Shameless. Okay, great. Marketing. All right. So, I'll get back to that. But what this is, where's my other thing? Okay. All right. What am I? I'm a crack addict. Okay. I'm a drug addict. Okay. These things were much better than everybody thought. They actually were. They really, really are. I was never going to have one of these. I actually bought the first iPhone the day it came out, and my plan was to keep a shrink wrap in the box until the year 2025 and sell it on eBay for about $1 million. Then my Windows-enabled phone and my Samsung Blackjack broke down the same day, and I had to go overseas. And I went, damn it! So I pulled the thing out of the box, and I plugged it in, and I went to iTunes, and I went, and it went, boom. I went, that's it. Works, right? This too, this is great. This is a media device. It's a media player. That's all it is, okay? Now, they were clever. They marketed it as laptop replacement, so it's not. But it's crack, all right? That's what it is. How do drug dealers do deals? They go, here, take it. And then you use it, and then all you need to have is that on it, you'll come back for more. Next one is going to have video. You know, why do you think they released this, then the iPhone 4? Oh, I need to have that video conferencing thing. Then AT&T's deal goes away. This is now available in Verizon in the US. Then what do? They put a Google Voice application on this. Skype announces that it's integrating with Facebook. Okay, these guys are all talking to each other. They're not doing this in absentia. And Apple knows what's going on. So the next one of these, right, the next one of these is going to have the face-to-face functionality. You're going to be able to make phone calls, stick in your earpiece, and do all that kind of stuff. And I downloaded Pages and Keynote right away, not realizing I couldn't move my PowerPoint presentations over to that. What are you kidding me? But I don't care because you just stick it in the vein. You know?
It's, you can move PowerPoint presentations over to that. You can move.
I don't know how. If you could show me, that'd be great because I can't.
Yeah, I just, I've got them all in here. They just convert.
I tried to email them. They won't come on. Maybe I'm doing something wrong.
Really?
But that's because you're an actual user who reads manuals or figures it out, and I'm just a drug dealer who just goes, you know, I'm just addicted and I have to have it. And if it weren't for my son, I'd throw it away. So I think that, look, Apple makes unbelievable devices. They're a hardware company. Okay, now this is to me, it's just because this is going to help us use the hockey puck, Apple TV, $99. Right, they're going after Netflix. They're going after Amazon. Amazon's moving too slow. If I was Amazon, I'd just convert IMDb directly to a front page that says, what movie do you want to watch? Hey, I'm streaming right to that. So they're out in front. They build a beautiful piece. Everybody I know in the States who has one of those has the hockey puck. Right? And they shoot the hockey puck. You know, they shoot it from their 60-inch flat screen, shoot everything right on the iPad, take it on the plane, watch their movies. Right? This is the first time I think they're trying to get into the content space. And it's a stalking horse. Now remember, the iPod, when it first came out, was an $850 device that no one under 35 could afford. Now, what people don't realize is that the only music on iTunes was 80s stuff. It was old Madonna. It was Tears for Fears. You know, it was Flock of Seagulls. Why? Nobody wanted that shit. Nobody in college wanted that crap. Well, that was by design, because nobody in college can afford an iPod. So 35-year-olds who grew up with 80s music went out and bought the new piece of crack, loaded it up with all their old 80s things, and did all that, you know, kind of like 80s dancing stuff and all that stuff. And then it's a $10,000 revenue stream. Then, because they sold so many iPods, they're not making any money on the music, they were able to then go and get the big bands, right? Hardware paying for content. But people think that when an iPod launched, it had the entire universe's music library. No, it was Madonna and Prince. Because the only people that could afford that stuff were people who grew up in the 80s. So, to this, I'm doing a social media experiment on behalf of my ownership of the company. Nobody in this company, all the authors, I mean, the guy who wrote Fleck called me yesterday. He's like, what have you done on Facebook? And can you do it for me? My book is the highest selling book in the entire company's history after 36 hours. Because I put it on LinkedIn, Plaxo, Twitter, and Facebook.
Yeah. Well, are you reaching the like soccer moms that want to get this to their kids? Is that what you're saying? So, but how about for the traditionalists that are still reading their kids a book?
Like, right.
Can you convince them that they should buy an iPad as well?
No, that's the problem, right? Is that my book is $299, which means you have to spend $502.99 to read my book. It's ridiculous. Mm-hmm. But we're proving a technology can be elegantly adopted on one platform. The same technology can be put on an Android and all of the mobile operating systems. I just did a deal with this company called Yuzu out of Sydney that's going to take my book and Harry and Flick and put it on iPhones. Right? It won't have all the functionality, but it'll be 99 cents, and then if you want another language, it's another 99 cents, and if you want paint, it's another 99 cents and stuff. So we're basically, because that company, Yuzu, already can set up channels and has payment gateways and has relationships, contractual relationships, with 226 telco carriers around the world, all I gotta do is shoot a file of that, and they create a channel on mobile, and then they, because this already is in 15 languages, I'm already in all the languages that Yuzu's in. So the strategy is go get huge, gigantic titles, use social media, raise the money fast, do it all at the same time, do a bunch of collateral deals, which will make sure that the entry price is not $502.99. You are hitting the nail directly on the head, right? We're not selling anybody of Harry. Why? You need an iPad. That's dumb. But all you have to do, I mean, they've built an engine that once it's done on the iPad, it just goes immediately to all of them. So it's on the Android App Store right now. So, but you still need that device, right? I want to put it on mobile phones. I want to put it on here. You know, I want to put it on here, but you can't. This is still not touchscreen, right? But maybe we do a free version. You just read it. It just gets read to you, right? David Tennant just reads you Harry McClary on that. But because this book company is all technologists, they're going, yeah, but I can build a better widget. I'm like, you're not selling that one. So my job's to come in and go, hang on, let's create revenue, let's create break-even, let's create profitability, let's talk about market penetration. And look, I can sit there and talk to the technologist all day about that, or I can go, look, just sit in the room, drink some more Red Bull, load you up with Doritos, close the door, I'll get you some more orders, I'll be back in about 2 days. Until then, just chill out, play some World of Warcraft, be cool.
Back to social media and what's on your mind form of communication, have you noticed that a lot of people nowadays are generally Generation Y's tend to just talk about, like you were saying before, they're just talking about what exactly it is that they're doing, and not a lot of it has content. Has that affected you consulting for people or even having marketing certain things?
My Facebook page is entirely curated. There's two reasons for that. One is that because I was the first person outside of college, you know, I mean, I was one of 7 million people, right? I've been on Facebook a long time. I got a lot of friends, a lot of people I know. But it was also like because Facebook started, like Facebook's tagline now is the social utility that connects you to people or something like that. It used to be connects you to people you know, right? I was under the impression that Facebook was to have a different sort of relationship with someone I actually physically know. Like, I would recognize if they walked in the room. But because there was no cap on friends, I ended up with 27,000 friends on Facebook. Go to a conference, Facebook hashtags up there, right? I thought it was a marketing platform. And then I went, you know what? I'm not working anymore. I'm just updating my Facebook page. And I'm updating it with less and less valuable information because I'm not actually doing anything. Then I realized that there are some people like me. I'm not saying that's what everybody has to do. But for me, Facebook has become a research and broadcast mechanism. Because everybody that's getting this, they're all studio heads, they're all publishing people, they're all, you know, they are influence makers. And what they will do is they'll send it out to their friends. Right.
It's the network of people that you have.
My network. I've shrunk my 27,000 down to like 250. Because also, every time I post something, they respond. And every time they post something, it's valuable to me. Has it been in my consulting career? Yeah, because there was a two-year period where everybody in the world thought that me and a couple other people like me, like Sharon and other people, were like, oh my God, we have to have a Twitter strategy! Not understanding that, yeah, okay, you're Coca-Cola. I can set up a Twitter page for you, but you do realize you need followers. Yeah, we can take these targeted messages to put out coupons. I'm like, no one's following you. So, Twitter's not a social media strategy, right? Social media is just it's another term, right? It's how we behave using technology to get out messaging, banal or important. So now, I tend to help people think organically about what they want. Like, what do you want? Okay, what's your outcome of this? You know, do you want to sell your company? Is that, do you want to have a trade sale? Do you want a list? Do you want your product to reach this many people? So let's reverse engineer. Okay, for example, if you are a content management system platform that has some interesting features and tools, and you're new in the market, you're never going to beat Brightcove, and you're never going to beat Maven, and you're never going to meet Move Networks. Never, 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 right? You want to get bought by them. Or you want to get bought by a major media company. So that narrows your list. Now you've got AOL, Time Warner, Google, BBC, News Corp, Yahoo, Microsoft, who else? You know, a couple others, right? So let's say there's 15 companies in the world, Sony, Viacom. Right, IG. All right, that's your strategy. That's your entire strategy. Everything you do, every single thing you do, from what you build to who you hire to how you do your sales and marketing to what your site looks like to the products to your marketing. If you're doing a deal with anyone who is not affiliated with those companies, you're an idiot. You're wasting your time because you want them to buy you. Right? I mean, there was a little company called KickApps. Right? Now there was Ning, there was KickApps, and then there was Flux. right? And no, it's Flux. Okay, kickoff Flux. Now, name, Mark Andreessen, who built Netscape and invested in Facebook, he went out and raised $100 million, and he's going to be the be-all to end-all of social media platforms, social networking platforms. Kickoff's is struggling and I'm trying to figure out what they want to do. Flux comes in and says, I want to get bought in 24 months. I'm going to go raise $6 million. And I'm not going to do a deal with anybody and any company that's not Viacom related. So they went and built a little site for Comedy Central, a little site for Jackass, a little site for MTVU, a little site for this. And that's like a virus. It spreads. You know, a person down the hall of marketing goes, hey, dude, how'd you get that Jackass site up? Oh, I just used these tools. Right? It's another license. There's another $1,000. Another $1,000. Right? 2.5 years later, this company sold to Viacom for $500 million. Ning raised $100 million. They're making, I don't know, $1 million a month. Guys who built Flux are on a boat in Mallorca. Drink champagne. And so the strategy becomes, you can't have one strategy. So what do you want to do? What's on your mind? Okay, philosophical question. What do you want to do? What's your goal? Okay, you've got, you know, this. It's orange juice. We want to be the best fruit created beverage ever. Wrong. You want people to drink the damn stuff. Right? So figure out how to get people to drink your damn orange juice and get put in the shelves, not down here, right, where moms aren't going to bend. You want to be eye level. Right? It's all just kind of stuff. We all know this stuff. But all this noise comes in. Social media noise and Twitter noise and distribution noise, and it all comes, it's all the same damn thing. And I'm not a genius. I mean, I just don't know. I've got a PhD in poetry. I've never taken a finance, marketing, or economics class in my life. Never taken a business class, no idea. Have no idea how to even open Excel. Cannot use Excel, it baffles me. People say, I need some numbers. I'm like, good, I'll call up the CFO guy, and I'll be like, dude, do that Excel thing. Here's what I want. He's like, well, you should check the numbers. I'm like, no, God, no. No idea. But that's because I'm not afraid to say it. Everybody runs around and says, I have to be an expert. You know, you can fit the stuff I don't know in a footy stadium. But I know one thing well. I know how to look somebody in the eye and ask them for money. And then all the guys doing this or, you know, doing this, they all get paid. So.
Andre, you had a question.
Yeah. A lot of the stuff that you've done is obviously based around viral campaigns through Facebook and stuff like that. I'm pretty interested in that because I've actually tried that on a number of projects, and it's actually a short film that's taken off us recently, getting about 200 hits a day, and it's just slowly
yep.
building up in pace, and we're not doing anything.
Yeah.
Is there such thing as actually saying to someone, we're going to create a viral campaign?
Mm-hmm.
And second question is, can you ever guarantee that something is actually going to take off, or is there an X factor there that you have no idea? It really comes
the X factor shrinking. The answer is yes, yes, and yes. So many people don't know this, but you all know. Okay, bad sentence construction. So we all know New York Times bestseller list, right? It's New York Times. Okay, there's a rate card. There's a rate card. What that means is that if you want your book to be New York Times bestseller, you have to pay $250,000 a week. Period. That's how it becomes a bestseller. Period. If I wanted Sam, the biggest fire truck, to be New York Times bestseller for 1 week, I write the New York Times a check for $250,000. Now, if I want number two, it's $200,000. If I want number three, it's $175,000. See where I'm going here? You know, and now, viral campaigns. So we all remember Lonely Girl, right? Remember that? Yeah. You guys know Lonely Girl?
Yeah.
Right? Okay, that was a viral campaign that was set up. It was all engineered, entirely scripted, completely. Now, what the problem is they got busted. They lied too long. They didn't admit it, but it was set up by an agency. You could, with sufficient amount of money, hire any one of a series of remarkable social media, digital engagement, interactivity, metric-based video view in multi-platform agencies, they're all just changing their names every 2 minutes, to create a viral campaign that would have guaranteed metrics. Now, what they'll tell you is they'll say, we'll get you 2 million video views a month. They actually know they can get 12. And they'll come back to you and they say, we got 12. You should hire us again. Right? Pick my numbers, man. It's Google Analytics. It's just a little SEO, a little SEM, a little keyword building, a little link building. It's paint by numbers. Now, it costs money. There are people who do it mechanically, and there are people who do it organically. On my team here, so I realized this was really important and had no idea what all that stuff meant. So I have two partners. One used to run Sony Home Video, and then he was the head of business development for Universal Music Group. And the, my other partner is the creator of Google Analytics. And she runs, she's on the board of Google. So when I want anything to get Google listing, number one, for example, let's just go to Google. All right, now, see this, I'm gonna show you right here how non-X factor it is. All right. So, all right, Santa Big Fire Truck. My book's been out for how long? 2 days? Bam, number one. Number one, number two, number three, number four, number five, number six. How do you think I got that? Hey, Dawn. Jack Sam. So she went and went, bam, done. He's number one. So there's all this stuff that we all get addicted to. You know, it's Blair Witch Project. It's Paranormal Activity. It's Lonely Girl. It's that one in a billion. It's that one in a zillion that makes it because it just can't, just right time. Bullshit. None of it. Is, look, I called my partner, she called Larry and Sergey and said, look, I got a favor, I gotta call in. Okay, we need Sam the biggest fire truck to hit number one. Doing okay. That's how it happens. It's unsexy, it's horrible, it's unfair, but it's how it happens. Now, there's always something that sneaks through. But you wanna play those odds? Right? You got talent, you got drive, you got vision, you believe in your product, you really want it to work. Are you going to bust your balls for the next 10 years hoping that somebody somewhere sees it somehow and takes it to Spielberg and get to da? Or, you know, you're going to go out and say, look, you know, I got this lawyer friend of mine and he made a shitload of money because he had some Google options early on and you know what, I need 100 grand and I'm going to go pay somebody to do that. And you win. Problem with winning is that everybody hates you. Right? It's easy to be second. Then you can bitch.
No, man, studio guys, they don't understand me. You know, my vision is so amazing. They don't understand me because I'm going to take on the world.
You're out of your mind. You know? You're out of your mind. So it's about getting, it's not about getting jaded. It's about realizing how it works. Right? So, yes, you can pay somebody to do a viral campaign. Yes, guaranteed. Costs money. And you get what you pay for. Meet a guy at a party. Oh, man, I can do SEO. I'll do it for you for $5,000. Okay. Or,
hello.
You know? So.
That, I just, it still doesn't stop the problem or the issue that moms cooking in the kitchen don't have an iPad to look at that. So the people right. looking at that are people my age who don't want to buy that.
Right.
So how are you going to sell that?
I'm not worried about selling my book. I'm worried about selling anything by my company, including the fact that we just got Cowboys and Aliens and Men in Black and Ann Getty's new book, Beginnings, and we're going to be doing picture books and National Geographic stuff and all these things. I want people to get used to the idea that on tablet PC and mobile devices, you can find something that you will consume. Because one of the things that statistically is bubbling up is that the vast majority of people who have these are parents.
Yeah.
Okay? Now, you're not going to get one of these yet. But guess what? The next one of these will be $200. And then it'll be $99. And then they'll start taking them, they'll do a Chinese version of this. That'll be $30 at Harvey Norman with an Android in it. Then you'll get it, right? And then you can go get, you know, you can go get these. Because by the time that happens, which will only be a year away, I'll have everything. I'll have Who Weekly, I'll have Vogue, I'll have Cosmo, I'll have everything. I'll have it all. Now, all that stuff's already on there without the interactivity, right? I'm doing a deal with Atari that's back, where they bought a children's book library where they made games from half the titles. What you're going to be able to do is read the book, right? Go right through with your four-year-old, ching, 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 and then you can click on the character and it'll take you instantly into the game. Because Atari's not going console, they're going all online. It's genius, you know? So I don't care if you don't buy Sam, right? I want you to know that these books are available because it's going to be something. The more I can keep it right there on that site, the more people are going to go to it. And they're going to and by the time there's something for you, you'll be able to afford it.
I actually think a lot of 30-something people who bought the iPod the first time it came out found that the iPad wasn't as useful as the iPod, except when they gave it to their child and thought that it was a pacifier.
I was going to take
my
iPad.
My friends have handed those down very quickly.
I was going to take my iPad back until my son started reading.
Yeah.
That's it. I don't use it at all. So, I mean, this is why, like, you can probably see, this is pretty funny. Like, the cover's just trash. And if you look, see all the, like, all the grease? There's, like, peanut butter in there. You know, there's, like, chips. Like, look at that. There's chips. Like, this is all food, you know? Because I can't get it away from it. I had to bring it down here. He's like, no! You know, so.
We're going to let Chris have a break in a second, but I just want to have one last question.
Sure.
Which ties back into the fact we're at uni, we teach people who hopefully go out into these careers. As someone operating in this space and also employing people in this space, above and beyond the degree, what personal qualities do you think you need?
Have to wait tables. You have to wait tables. I won't hire anybody who wasn't a waiter or a waitress. Period. Because you're dealing with horrible, terrible, obnoxious people who are silly and drunk and rich and think you're a piece of crap. And then you're dealing with diva chefs in the back and busboys that are drunk and people who don't show up. And you have to be cool, calm, under pressure, deal with people, multitask, all that kind of stuff. That, to me, is very important. That's, to me, what the bigger metaphor of that is that qualities that are important. It's like, you know, I rue the death of the Renaissance person. You know, where history and geography and arts and science and music and all those things are gone. Now, we do have, you know, Sharon studied geography in school. Well, we don't need that anymore because we have Google Maps. Okay? Although, I think that qualities you have to have is curiosity. You have to be confident, not aggressive. Right? There's no more. This country has mentoring. It's beautiful. Apprenticeship. How cool is that? You know, in America, if you're not a genius by 20 and a billionaire by 30, you're a loser. Just put a bullet in your mouth. You know? Right? It's ridiculous. So I think that you have to look at what degree you think is going to best help you become confident. Look, college is about getting a personality, right? As much as it is about getting an education. If you sit in your room and you just write code, or you just hang out with all those, like, depressing, dark filmmakers, sit in their rooms and sip coffee, right? You know, problem with being a director is at a certain point you get into a relationship and your girlfriend says, yeah, I know you're all dead, but just take out the fucking garbage, you know? You have to be a human being. Right, and I think that there's so much stuff that in the grind to find the job and all that gets lost. I mean, you got to go out and have fun. You got to sit down with people. You know, I mean, Twitter is not exactly a dating strategy. I don't know if I'm answering this really well, but it's kind of my philosophical thoughts on education. Is that, you know, high school is about getting over the pain of puberty. College is about getting a personality. Graduate school is about refining it down. Or you know what you want to do already, screw it all and go do it. But it's about execution, you know, about doing things, building products. What I love is that I've done all this stuff, right? All this stuff, okay? And what can I hold in my hands? I can't hold Facebook in my hands. You know, I can't hold an Inconvenient Truth in my hands. I mean, I can hold a DVD, but is that what it is? But you know what? I can hold Sam. You know, I'm more proud of Sam than I've been of anything I've ever achieved, because it was my head, my son, and I can hold it in my hands. You know, and doing things, having something, finishing something, you know, executing, having the dream, using education, mentoring, teachers, this environment to complete something. And that doesn't just take a degree. It doesn't just take, like, well, I'm going to just be a doco maker, right? You don't know how to do everything, because it's all hard. I mean, that's what I think. You know, look, I'm a guy who grew up on a farm with a PhD in poetry, and that's what I do. You know, so.
Okay, on that note, yeah. I'd like to thank Sharon for facilitating this, Andre for filming it, David
thank you all for
the organizing
coming.
And the catering, thank you very much. Kerry for the money.
thank you.
The audience, and especially thank Bruce.
Oh, it's delightful. I hope it was useful to you guys.